amazing to see how God does things at times. And before we get any further, let us just look to the Lord in prayer. Eternal God, I truly want to thank you for the privilege of being here. As I'm about to share your word now, I ask that you just take full control, dear God. Hide me behind the cross, and that you may just take control of my lips, my mouth, everything I say may be to the honor and glory of your name. Help someone to be truly blessed from what is to be shared today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now let me start with a little quick story. Yes. Now, you all know my nephew Jay, right, when he came to visit me. Tall, almost 6 footer, kind of looks like me. He says no. But yeah, Jay, when Jay comes to visit, when I was about to put this scripture down, it made me understand how much we can miss things. Now, Jay and I would be in the living room watching TV. He's right there on the couch. I'm right here in my easy chair, and we're watching TV. Now, whatever he's watching interests him, but I want to get his attention to do something. And I said, Jay, he's just in the TV. I said, Jay, and he's still in the TV. I actually have to get up out of my easy chair, walk over to him, and say, Jay, oh, yes, Uncle. He is so entrenched in the television that it's like no matter what I was saying, I could not get his attention. No, what I realized, if we are not careful, we can grow through life just like Jay and miss what God is saying to us. We would be so entrenched in our lives or our situation that is going on around us that we don't realize God is trying to get our attention. Wow. Listen, as children of God, it is important that we stop, look, and listen to what God has to say to us. Right? You would think if anybody, you know, has God's attention, it would be his children, right? Wrong. Most of the times we fall into the category of not hearing what God has to say because he has not gotten our attention. Now, I realize this. If we as children of God struggle with God getting our attention, how much more can people who don't believe in God? It's hard. Because if we're struggling with it and they don't even believe in God, they ain't going to see the signs. Right? That is why this morning, my sermon topic is this. What does God have to do to get your attention? See, I got a loudspeaker up this morning. Because I want God to get our attention. Now, the first thing I want to talk about this morning is this. Whether a child of God or not, God puts different things or situations in our lives for us to acknowledge him. This is the fact of the matter. That God tries to get our attention with different situations, different circumstances, but half the time, we're not paying any attention. We don't even realize God is speaking to us. And then guess what? We're wondering what is happening, what's going on, and we're trying to figure it out, but we never even ask God. Right? We need to understand with these signs, if we don't acknowledge him, we are going to miss whatever he's trying to say to us. The thing is, sometimes we find help, or we try to figure it out with other persons. You know, some person, they go ask their mom, they go ask their dad, brother, sister, any family, they go and ask other persons. And everybody tries to find out what is going on and ask him all these different questions. But nobody asks God. And that's where we fall short a lot of times as Christians. We forget to talk to God. Many times,
God gets our attention.
But for a split second.
You ever know those split second persons, you know? Jay's one of them. Because it's so funny. With the TV, you say, yes, uncle. And he turns and he looks at me and I said, Jay, I want you to do this. Yes, uncle. And he's back in the TV. I said, Jay, didn't I just talk to you? What did you say, uncle? He answered me. But his attention is gone. And that is just how we are. Sometimes God gets our attention. We acknowledge him today. And tomorrow we forget that we were talking to God. Right? I've learned something. God wants our attention so that he can become our God. And you're like, what are you saying, Pastor? I got a little equation for you this morning. And if you can jot it down, jot it down. Look at this. Pray for me
equals my God. You pray equals your God. And we pray equals our God.
What are you saying right there, Pastor? Let me break down this equation for you. Many times people come to me and say, Pastor, pray for me. This is happening in my life. No, there's nothing wrong with that. Don't think you can't come to the person and say, pray for me. That is good. But when you come to me and say, pray for me, I'm at the first part of the equation. I'm talking to my God on your behalf. So when you say, pray for me, I'm talking to my God. But to make this better and make it stronger, if you notice a plus sign is there, I want you to be praying as well. Because it makes it stronger when we both reach out to heaven and talk to him. So you pray so that God can become your God. Because this is the thing. If I'm the only one talking to God, it makes me seem like I'm the only one that has a relationship with him. If I pray for you all the time and you're not even praying for yourself, then you're looking to me to get to my God. And I don't own the rights on God. No. So when you say, pray for me, yes, I will, because I pray to my God. But you need to pray too, because when you pray, that shows you have a relationship with God. So then God becomes your God. And when both of us are interceding and praying to God, then God becomes our God. That is something we all need to understand. It's not just my God. It's not just your God. It's our God. God is for everybody. So when God is trying to get our attention, he wants to be our God. He doesn't just want to be my God or Pastor God or Tawbalakim God. He wants to be everybody's God. Right? Many times, I want to show you this as well. Many times, we know God is trying to get our attention, but... Now there's a saying. Anytime there's a but with man, there's a problem. But when there's a but with God, there's a miracle. But this time the but is not with God, it's with man. Right? God is trying to get our attention, but, and this is some of the situations. Look at this one here. We deflect. What is deflecting? What are you talking about? We deflect, Pastor. Let me give you an example. We're at choir practice. Let me pick on my friend Lynn. We're at choir practice, and we're practicing, and we're singing. Everything is going good. We finish the first verse, Lynn stops, and she says, Pastor, I'm not hearing that wonderful tenor that you are singing anymore. You all know that's a lie, right? But she says, I'm not hearing that wonderful tenor. Why are you not singing the tenor, Pastor? Now, Lynn talked to me, right? I reach over and I hit Doug. Doug, why are you not singing the tenor? Who did Lynn talk to? Me. Why am I hitting Doug? The question was posed to me. And many times this is what is happening in our lives. God is trying to get our attention. And instead of saying, what are you saying, God? Okay, you want me to do what? You say,
oh, let Jeanette do it. She's been here a long time. Oh, let this new person do it. I'm old. I've been here too long.
But we deflect and we keep passing the buck. We deflect. And God is trying to get our attention for a specific reason. We need to stop doing that. Another reason that causes the but is this. Oh, we don't want any responsibility. Oh my Lord. This is the house of God.
Get Sylvia to do it. Get Kelly to do it. You know, get someone else to do it. You know, why can't you do it? I don't want all that responsibility. That's too much.
You think God would have asked you to do something if you weren't capable? Certainly God would have not called me here to be the music director.
Right, Liz? Because I cannot read a note to save my life. When I am in at choir practice, I am the special student.
Because I cannot read notes, I cannot do everything, and they have to do everything slower for me. But the reason is God called somebody else to be the music director, not me, because that is not my responsibility. But can you imagine if God called Lynn to be the music director and she's like,
well, I don't want to be in charge of a church right now.
Or better yet, when God called me to the ministry and said to come here to talk for Hawking, I looked at God and said, well, I just left Bible college, God, you know, I need a year off. You know, I got to deal with some issues. So next year, I'll come back and see how that goes.
I can't work with God.
We need to take up our responsibilities. The next problem we find with the butt syndrome is this.
Look at this. We assume.
Uh-oh.
God is trying to get our attention, but we assume he's calling us to be a pastor. We assume he's calling us to lead the children to the promised land. We assume he's calling. Why are you assuming? You don't even hear what God is saying to you yet, and you're already assuming that God is calling you to do this. Sometimes God wants to get your attention for a simple little thing, like, I want you to go next door and talk with your neighbor because they're struggling with something. The mere fact God is trying to get our attention, we should listen. Don't think in our mind, well, God can't call me to be Elijah, or God can't call me to be Moses. You don't know what he's saying to you. Stop assuming and listen. You know what they say about assume?
I don't need to repeat it. Go check it out. Google it.
Right? Finally, I want people to realize, look at this.
Don't let God have to stop you, look at this, stop you on life's pathway to get your attention.
Oh my Lord.
Don't let God have to do that. In other words, don't let God have to arrest you.
I hate when that happens, because when God arrests you, he arrests you good. You can't move. There is no bail until you surrender. Yeah. Look at Nebuchadnezzar.
Look at this. Let's read the scripture. That very hour, the word was fulfilled concerning Nebuchadnezzar. He was driven from men and ate grass. Oh, Lord. Now, you all know I love my food. Now, can you imagine if my meals were only grass? That's going to be hard. So he only ate grass like oxen. His body was wet with the dew of heaven, till his hair had grown like eagles. I don't even have any hair. Feathers and his nails were like birds' claws. Wow, 7 years! God put Nebuchadnezzar in the field with the cows and the goats and all those people eating grass on all fours, because he would not listen to God when God was trying to get his attention. You see, God tried to get Nebuchadnezzar's attention in several ways. Let's look at them. The first one is this. Go. Signs. He gave Nebuchadnezzar many signs. Nebuchadnezzar had dreams that he could not interpret. You know, he was like, what's going on here? What are all these dreams? I don't know what's happening. And he was confused. But he had these dreams. He had signs. And many times God will put signs in our lives or circumstances that's easier for us to understand, for us to just stop and look up. But what we do, we try to continue where we are going, right? Apart from signs, he did this to Nebuchadnezzar. Warnings.
Daniel came to him. Daniel interpreted his dreams. Daniel said to him, just before this happened, it was a year before it happened, Daniel said to him, "No, Nebuchadnezzar, this is what is going to happen to you." He told him that this is going to happen to him. And he says, just fall and worship God. Don't let this become. Don't do it. Can you imagine? Someone tells you, don't drive that way because the bridge is out. And the sign says, bridge out. And you're like, I want to see for myself. And you get all the way at the edge. And you look over and you're like, whoo. And then guess what? It collapses with you. But didn't someone warn you? The bridge was out. But you still went. And that's what happened to Nebuchadnezzar. He got warnings. Sometimes God is trying to get our attention and he gives us signs. He gives us warnings. And we still don't pay attention. So if he gives us the signs, he gives us the warnings, people come and talk to us, what's the next thing?
Being humbled before God. In other words, he arrests us. There was this great man of God, can't remember which one it is, but there was a time in his life when pride took over. And when pride took over, he forgot to give God the glory, so God had to strike him down. And he was stricken down in such a way that he was so ill, he could not move. The only thing he could do was lay in the hospital bed and look up. And when people came to visit him, they said, how are you doing? He says, I'm doing great now. And they said, but you're in bed. What was wrong with you? What? He says, no, but now I realize all I had to do was to look up. He just realized he had no other choice now but to look up to God. Pride, he had to be humbled now before God. And this is what God has to do a lot of times for us. He has to humble us. He has to arrest us just to get our attention. If we had learned from the first time and stopped to listen and honor, it would be great. But we did not. And God has to humble us. In conclusion, I want you to go to my next screen. Look at this. Now, if you look at the first sign says, stop, look, and listen. Now, they told me when I was growing up that the best method of learning is repetition. That's what they told me, so I guess it works. So I repeated the sign again. Stop, look, and listen. But guess what? They said it's the best repetition, so I added something more to it because they said when you repeat it the second time, add a little bit more so the persons can get it. The third sign says, stop, look, and listen to God. This is where we need to be as a church. God is trying to get our attention, and we are like all over the place. Don't be all over the place in our personal lives. Don't be all over the place when God is trying to get our attention. Stop, look, and listen. Pay attention to the signs. When you get them, pray and ask God, what are you saying to me? Don't be scared to approach God. Don't deflect. Don't assume, right? God might be trying to get your attention to help someone. He might be trying to get your attention to save someone's life. He might be trying to get your attention to save your own life. Many times, people end up in situations that cost them dearly, all because they weren't listening to God. Don't ignore God's warnings, because he might just have to stop you on life's pathway, and you have no other choice but that same man of God but to look up. Each of us now has to think on this question. How does God get my attention? Let us go to the Lord in prayer. Eternal God and most righteous Father, I just want to thank you for this word that was shared, dear God. That we as a church, we as individuals, miss so many signs that you have put in our lives. You send people to come and talk with us. You send warnings. You put everything for us just to pay attention so that we can look up to you. Dear God, you're an awesome God. While you're fighting for our attention, I don't know why.
But sometimes you want to use us. Sometimes you have things for us to do. And sometimes you're getting our attention for our own benefit. Sometimes you want to bless us. But we're so busy being us that we don't even realize that you're trying to do this for us. So dear God, we're asking now as a church, as an individual, that you just be with us. Don't give up on us, dear God. We ask now that you just take control of our lives. Continue to get our attention, dear God. We ask now, dear God, with a repentant heart, that if we have missed the signs in our lives, that if we have missed the different warnings, the different persons that you have sent to tell us, we want to say we're sorry. And we ask now, dear God, that we be more focused on you, that we pay more attention, dear God, that when you are trying to get our attention, we will surrender and say, here we are, so that we can be used of you to do your work, whatever it is. You could be just calling us to serve in the kitchen. You could be calling us to be a Sunday school teacher. You could be calling us just to talk to our neighbor, a family member. Your service and your work, dear God, goes beyond this building because we are the people of God. So, dear God, we're thankful for this word now. And we receive it with thanksgiving. In Jesus' mighty name we pray, as you taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on this earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So please don't let